Good evening, everyone. As usual, this is Vivek Prakash. You are welcome to this webinar of July 2013. Thank you very much for joining on time. To be effective at work as project manager, it is important to know what needs to be done before you do it. Now, what's great about it? It is so obvious. But many times, the obvious is not so obvious. Despite everyone knows that we must understand before we need to focus, where we need to focus on. Only few managers are really able to do so. For most of the managers, it is a continuous struggle. Though every project is unique and demand specific actions, but there are some fundamental principles, if bring into practice, will consistently give excellent results. Managers who follow these principles consistently demonstrate excellent performance and therefore fall into category of excellent managers. Some people have these qualities naturally. But most of people understand, learn and practice them until these qualities become their habits. Once they become habit, there is no looking back. They just come naturally. Today we will talk about five such habits and which can take anyone on the path of excellence. For the benefits of first-time participants, let me explain how we're going to conduct this webinar. By default, all participants are muted and will remain muted. However, it will not stop you asking questions. You can ask questions at any time by using question panel. It's always open. I will pause at logical point and take the questions from question panel. In case we run out of time without giving answers of all the questions, I will send responses of all the questions in an email to all the participants. Let's go over to the presentation on the session for which we have assembled here today. Okay, I will directly go to the things because we have only 1.5 hours and we have to give some time for the questions as well. I will directly go on to the things without anything around it. Okay, so the habit one is the first plan and then execute. Now you may be wondering that if this is what you need to learn from this webinar. It looks so obvious. But as I said, sometimes obvious is not so obvious. Though everyone knows that we need to plan first and then execute, the reality is far from this statement. The temptation of execution is so high. All the planning takes so much effort that people often try to shorten this period of planning and jump to the execution. Sometimes the pressure from the pressure is so much that people push for executions to give results faster. However, whenever it happens, the results come later. So this required real skill and practice to have patience and really push to the plan before we push to the execution. There will be several reasons for not planning. I will show you there. I normally categorize them as excuses. They simply rely on their intuition and do not like to plan. They say, okay, without plan, I can do. Maybe the project is not so big. Maybe I know everything about the project. We have to show results faster. So we directly jump to the execution and bring some quick results. However, what matters is the end result. We have done some planning and it is enough for now. Fair enough, but we have to come back and make this planning really better and better. But that should happen. We do not want to get into the planning paralysis. Some people find that planning is such a job that it will paralyze the whole project. And we will do only planning and we will not be any time for execution. Our project is too small to plan. Currently, we have little information about the project. We will plan later. Now, there is no project with the start with all the information. All projects start with a small information and progressively elaborate. MPMI say the same thing. We have too many changes in the requirement. That is the topmost, if I say all the excuses. This is the topmost because there is no project where the changes are not happening and every project manager thinks that his project is having the most changes. And therefore, because everything is changing, how to plan this? The thing is that more changes are there, more planning is required. The project is evolving and the situation is changing every day, the same thing as before. We are following agile methodology. That is the latest statement. So we have more and more software companies are adopting agile methodology and the perception is that the agile doesn't require any planning. I'm really not sure how this has been created, but that's the perception and you can hear this kind of statement many times. We have not seen any project executed as per plan. That's true actually. No project or hardly any project goes as per the plan, but if it doesn't go, the planning is required more. Plan or don't plan, real work will happen on weekends and in nights. Maybe the people are part of the projects where the planning was not so good and this was the way of the life. So people have adopted that life and accepted that this is the way to execute the project. First project for a new client always goes like that. Maybe that could be tougher, but it could be made better. Action is important, not the plan. Right, but action without any direction will not result nothing. Now there could be many such questions, such excuses. I can write as many excuses as you can think of, maybe. But the only thing that you see, the font will get reduced, and sometimes after some time will not be able to read it. Actually, what happens when these excuses come up and the planning doesn't take place? When the planning doesn't take place, what the first thing happens is that we don't understand the challenges which are going to come little later, not upfront. Especially the risks are not identified. The challenges could be risk, or risk could be challenges. If I see projects and the risk register of the projects, majority of the risk registers or majority of the projects have risk register having risk. More than 50-60% risk are same in all the projects, and they are so obvious they don't look like risk. Actually, they are simple issues. The risk which hit the project most is normally not there, or the risk which actually made the project to close down, those are never identified. Because they will never be, because the planning didn't take place. Fail to understand the customers what really want actually. the customers normally, they are not so good in articulating their requirements. Fail to analyze expectation of the stakeholders. If you do without expectation of the stakeholders, chances are more that there will be a mismatch. If WBS is not appropriate, which is the base of the rest of the planning, then it will lead to inappropriate estimations, inappropriate assignment, inappropriate resource uses, and so on. Now, if there is no planning, the direction is missing. What happens is that the pressure is the default thing which worked there or which will be used on the team to bring people on the weekends and stay late to get the project faster. It is almost definite that if the planning is not proper, the project will get delayed. First deliver, so the estimates are also not good. The 8-month project committed for 6 months. You will deliver 6 months, but customer will not be able to use it on 6 months when you first make the first delivery. When we do deliver and then repair it for next 1 month, 2 months or 3 months, and then the customer will be able to deploy. So actual delivery happen when the customer is able to deploy, not when we deliver it. This is how normally a project goes. If the planning, so what happens, initiation is fast tracked, so there is no charter. The project plans do not have a charter. Most of the project plans do not have charter. Now, this statement is actually wrong. Every project has a charter. Actually, without charter, there is no project. What I mean is that the charter is not documented. And when the things are not documented, they are not clear. They are hazy. What charter does, it clarifies why this project is being undertaken. A high-level plan is there. Right, estimations, we have not taken the transition from the pre-sales or the sales team, properly taken everything and just fast tracking on that. When this happens, we have not re-estimated the project, have not ensured that whatever the estimations are done as of now are valid. They have just gone off, and some people even forget about the kickoff meeting. So nobody knows in the organization that this project is kicked off. And when we go to the planning is something which is always hard, because the information is less at the beginning. A lot of things has to be guessed or understood or are hazy or not so clear. So it's difficult to put something together. But whatever information is there should be put together, but that's not, doesn't happen. So plan remain unclear, risks are not identified, challenges are not understood, stakeholders' expectations are not clear, but we move ahead and start execution. And when we do, then execution, we move into a spiral, a round in the execution of monitoring, execution and monitoring, execution and monitoring. And even the closer take more time than actually it's supposed to take. So what happens, we move into a downward spiral of getting stuck because the challenge was not understood. So whenever the challenge come or even the little challenge or risk materialize, we stuck. We do rework on the things which we have already done. Then we replan. So this replan is the reactive plan. So we move into a stuck rework and reactive planning all the time and stay, go downward, never, until unless we hold on and say, okay, we will plan rest of the things. Let's leave whatever is done. That this downward spiral will goes, and then you see that where we end up is that high on the schedule, high on budget, less on customer satisfaction, less on team satisfaction. Now it's very obvious. I think nothing to be explained here when we are moving to the spiral of execution and monitoring and control takes more and more time. And this is how a normally an excellent project manager normally plan he or she holds. They initiate the project, put the project project charter in place or do estimation at least before they move ahead, that how much is that? Is the validate the estimate at least whatever done? At least do a kickoff, tell everyone that what kind of support you need from different departments or different support function, how they will give you support when they don't know this project is kicked off. Many projects have not even having any kickoff, they don't call any support functions. Support functions do not know what is happening. Now, when you go to the planning, especially a strategy is to be developed. What is the strategy? That we do a virtual run of the project, try to see that what kind of challenges we can encounter, what kind of risk may come up, and prepare a mitigation or the some kind of plan to handle those things. And then when we move into execution, the execution time goes down and drastical change come into the monitoring and control. Not so much monitoring. People are more clear. The resources know that what is going to happen. They need not to be told every time. And therefore, the closure also take time, less time. And you see maybe that you can like to compare these two things, that how the normal project goes and how it goes. You will see that you will save considerable time and efforts and the cost and the satisfaction when it is better planned. Okay, I have some questions, so I will hold on before I move to this second habit. Okay, will this presentation will be shared or do you want us to note down points? No, you need not to note down the points. This presentation will be shared. Even the recording of this webinar will be available. What is WS full form? Work breakdown structure. Okay, will we have an access to this PPT as a soft copy? Yes, a PDF will be provided to you and the recording of this webinar will also be available on YouTube. Okay, let me move on. So the second habit is about managing boss. Now this is could be a little different side, not be as obvious as the previous one. You know, where there is a light, the darkest place is to the lamp, near the lamp is under it. And you know the blindest spot near a project manager is above him. The most untouched territory is building relationship with the boss and talking to the supervisor, talking to the my manager and seeing that how to manage that upward relationship. So the managers who effectively manage their team, projects, deliverables, everything is fine. But often there is a negligence towards the upward direction. In fact, this is a problem with a humankind, I can say. That a person is either the trade is either the downward or the upward. The person is either good in managing the upstream or is good in managing the downstream. Most of the managers are good in managing the downstream, not the upstream. So what happens, because this is the nature, the upward relationship is often take a hit. And you can easily judge that when this relationship is not working or not so working, the person who is on the downward side get hit most. And so it always hurt, and not only the person, but always also the company. So we need to take time and manage relationship with our boss, understand the expectation, understand the weaknesses, the strengths, what's his objective, goals, etc., and manage it. But really, things come exactly what is there to manage and why we should manage. Because to get a direction in my career, I'm the most important person. I have to act on it. But the next important person is my boss, who will take it to the right direction. If I have not discussed my direction with my boss and his direction and my directions are different, the chances of messing up is more. He's the most important person, deciding what matters most for me. Because I'm basically taking his one or two goals or objectives I have hired, and I'm going to contribute there. If I'm not achieving, he'll not achieve. His success is depend on our success. If we do not contribute to his success, he will not be succeed, and therefore will also not succeed. Even he may be he must be relying on you, or relying on everyone rely on their subordinates. So we need to understand that where we stand, where we are contributing. Are we the critical? Is relying on us? Basically, if my boss is not relying on me, then I'm maybe doing a side work, may not be important. And in fact, being in such a area will not be a good idea to stay for long. So get away, basically, if we are in such a situation. And if we develop this relationship, definitely, because it is one-to-one, my objectives are met by him and his objectives are met by me, it is a win-win relationship. The problem is that if this relationship is not working well, it is the person on the downward side will get the most hit. So it is the me who will get most of the hit. The hit to manager will be less. If he sees that I may not be working or I may not be able to deliver, he has other reports also. He may manage things through other reports as well, but I may not be. And these qualities are only work with boss, no other person, my manager. But how to know this relationship is working well or is shaky? So there are some checkpoints. If my manager asks more questions than I expect, then the things are not right. Maybe I have to do something. My manager asks me more status, most frequently the status than I think it should be, or we have understood, or we have set up a weekly or bi-weekly, but he's asking more frequently. There's something wrong. Trying to micromanage, these all are symbols of untrust or losing trust. We have often disagreement. So we go into the arguments on many points, not one point, 2 points. Sometimes it is, but if it is happening more frequently, there is a problem. Or my boss is asking me to do something which is not so worthy. That is also a sign of that I may not be critical in his team, in her team. Now this could be a little even worse, that I deliver something and he asks someone to verify that. That is even a problem. So these are some guidelines. They're not the only guidelines. Just see that, keep checking on some, list down some parameters, keep checking on how things are going. And there is a time when you see something like that, it is the time to talk. So then we need to understand, when we talk, how to manage this relationship. The thing is that being the proactive approach, that proactively we should know what are the goals and objective of my boss and what are the critical deliverables. Now many people do not know, even the managers do not know, even the senior managers do not know. It is not so obvious. Normally people do not share with their subordinates so easily until unless you ask four times. That is the problem. With the people, with everyone, even I may be like that. But so it is required an action, active participation to go and talk about those things so that we know what is critical and talk and work on those critical things and see that we are part of those things. Facilitate faster decisions. So it's not very uncommon, or it's very frequent that boss will send that I need a report in 1 hour. I need the data by tomorrow. I need the data in a half an hour. Do you have this ready? This is keep happening. Now in that case, it is not the data to be supplied. It is the information which is meaningful to the other person. It is a boss, so it is anyone. Don't ask for opinion if it is not necessary. This is very important actually. Now, what happens when we are talking about our boss and we ask for some opinion or some suggestion? You know, boss suggestions are not just suggestions. They become constraint. They are almost like become mandatory to go this way or similar to that way. Or you have to justify that why you are not going that way if it is a suggestion. So the best thing is that ask suggestion where only required. Don't ask suggestions where they are not required. Second point, if you are asking too many suggestions, then your boss will think that you are playing a safe game. Everything you want to see that, okay, you told me to do this like that. So you don't want to take any of this. You're playing very safe. You don't want to take responsibility, accountability like that. Such a perception may get created. So asking more opinion is not. So you see that every time you ask opinion, vet it is really required, then only ask it. Otherwise, doing the job and then getting a response that no, this is right, that is better. But delivering something here and there is much better than asking and then doing it. Maybe you are right, but the perception will get created is that we don't want to take the accountability. Now the communicate. This is the most important, and communication is like that unless this work with every relationship, not only with boss. And the thing is that unless you tell something, don't assume that other person know it. Many times the perception or the assumptions are different because of the different context, especially when you are not co-located. So it's better to put things in the words, on the paper, on the mails. Let's not be too formal about it, but let's keep communicating and let your boss knows where you are working, where you are contributing, what are the critical things you are doing, where you are contributing. Let him know about it. Or let's keep talking actually. The basically thing is that. And never argue. As I said, sometimes we have the difference of opinion, but I will say never argue. Argument means I'm trying to prove that I'm right or something you are wrong, which never help. More we tell that I'm right or you are wrong, more the opinion get, more study, more powerful, and the person put his point of view even with more power. So never argue, especially with the boss. And in fact, it should not be with anyone, but the boss, it should be. Never argue. Let's try to understand and try to get to the previous point, communicate and say when there is an argument, there is a misunderstanding at one point. Either I have misunderstood or my boss has misunderstood. Let's put the fact together. let's look around the facts. What are the facts? And put the facts together and see that why we have reached to a conclusion. Either I will get right if I'm wrong with those facts, or I will make the opinion of my boss different. Because facts cannot be changed, cannot be countered, cannot be argued. You do not have opinion on that. Many times because we go into argument because the facts are missing. Look for short wins. Now this, what is the short wins? And short wins doesn't mean that you do manipulation. It's not manipulation. Short win means look around that where we can do something and can make life simple, not only the boss, but also the whole team, which may be a boss team, maybe my peers. There are always more things than we can do. Let I say the second point, the facilitate information, not the data. Now there's always a lot of dump of data, but making out meaning is different, is difficult. You may find that there are data available, but there are some frequent reports or frequent information we need them again and again. But you will see that many places, I'm just giving an example, just one example. There could be many, many more things if you look around. There will be several things lying here and there. Nobody was taking care of that. Maybe you can you will see that if you can make meaningful, you can pick up those things and create some meaningful. So some data is there. You create some kind of if template which convert this data into an information. So every time you are trying to do these things will get reduced and everyone gets. Maybe you have some skills which can be shared with other people. So you have a training session, a knowledge sharing session, or something like that, which I am trying to do here. Let's disperse the knowledge. More knowledge we disperse, more we get, and more we become popular, and more the other people will appreciate, and definitely the boss will appreciate, because it is the knowledge of the boss's domain is actually increasing, improving. So look for things which are lying here and there, but nobody attending them. Maybe they don't need too much time, but they will help a lot. Now this is everybody says, but it's difficult to do. But say, do not promise if you cannot deliver. Again, I will say, I say never argue. I think bring the facts together, put all facts together, and see that why we are promising more than what is expected or less than what is expected. And don't be sloppy with your deliveries. Definitely our deliverable should be good. So if the documentation is there, or even the simple documentation, there should be not many things for boss to do in that. Moreover, if whatever boss supposed to do, even if we do some part of that, will be much more healthy. I will say that if you see the time management quadrant of Stephen Covey, and the urgent, important, the request from the boss is kept into an important quadrant. Because boss is important for us, so all the requests of the boss become by default important. So any kind of negligence could be harmful, but let's not go to the buttering kind of things. That will not be appreciated, will not happen. You will never get appreciated on buttering kind of things. Let's act on the things. Let's make meaningful job. Let's make people happy, the boss and the people around. Boss team, it's not this. If the relationship is not healthy, what we need to do to find out the issues, problems, and own to resolve. As I said, the more impact party is me. So it is my responsibility, or I should own to resolve the problems. Now, this is something like I say, 5% of the people will not fit into any framework. Okay. So there will be, you may get hang to some boss who is really difficult to manage. I think better don't try to manage, get away. But let's do not reach to this conclusion very fast. Let's vet it that it is really the case, because people can reach to this conclusion very fast. and this may not be in your interest as such, because it is difficult to get away from the boss as such in any condition. Now what can happen is that if things are not going well and you procrastinate, you hope that okay, the things will become good, or maybe the things will become right, or some with the hope I don't do anything, I will say nothing worse can happen than that. If you see that things are not right, even if you suspect, they say go and talk. The main thing is that hit the point, act and manage it. Be proactive. Let's act. Let's be active. Let's act and talk. If even if we are suspecting the relationship that it is really healthy or not healthy, let's get clarified. Let's talk and see that if the things are really. But talking to boss is always very diplomatic. So getting to the crux of the story is normally it's not so easy. So it really required practice. And with anyone as such, the people are normally diplomatic, but I have seen the bosses are normally more diplomatic than the other people. Let's get to the third habit. And the third is this, that live for their team members. We talk about the upward relationship, but let's talk about the downward relationship. Though it's, again, it looks so obvious, but it is not so. Because just look at this. What is a normal practice? Normal practice is what my team members can do for me. Whenever I get people, I see what they can do for me. What normally do, we look into a team member. Does he or she possess the required technical skills? So first, recruiting a person on my project, getting a person onboarded on my project, the first thing is technical skills. The first parameter is technical skills. The person is having a real technical skills on this project or not. Sufficient experience is not there. A 5-year experience person is required. 3 years will not work. Okay, I will look for 5 years only. Is he willing to learn? Now, how will you judge it? You ask the person. Will you willing to learn? 101% get the answer in yes. I don't know, there is no way to really judge this, but we expect this. Require further training in any skills? That could be a pain also, right? The person is having a skill gap. Now he give him training, then like I started working for him, then he worked for me as such. Who is working for the project? He should demonstrate a positive attitude. Now this definition itself is a thing. It's a very perspective. My attitude will tell me that what is the attitude of the person in front of me. So everyone point that they should be have a positive attitude. Of course, everyone should have the positive attitude. Is there any constraint in contributing to the project? Is there any way that he will, instead of going to 6 o'clock, he will say, okay, I have to go at 5 o'clock. Or I have some problems, or the person who is coming on board is just deliver a baby and want to go early home. So that could be a problem. So should we take this person or not, take this lady or not? There could be many, many, many more expectations. The question is there any problem in asking this question? What is the problem in asking this question? Let me look at if there are some questions in that before you ponder on this question. How do we check whether the person has positive attitude? No, very difficult actually. You talk to the person, everybody will say that I have a positive attitude. We'll talk about it. Okay, very good. So is there any problem in asking this question? The answer is no. These questions need to be asked. These are basic parameters to have a person on board. But the problem is that we are testing the person actually, that what this person can do on this project. And we are basically in test mode. And this testing mode or the evaluation mode is actually the problem. Because we set up so many expectations from the people that even before the person start on the project, he is having so much burden on him on the of the expectations which are already set in the first interview, that what this project, some I can tell you that the project manager taking a new person and saying, okay, what you can do is also setting expectation that our project is very aggressive and you may need to sit every day up to 10 o'clock in the night. The person will run away the next day. Okay, may not come back. You will just maybe leave the organization also, you never know. So these questions are even not uncommon. I just didn't write. I write only the very common ones. So we get into several issues with the people because of those. And we, because our expectations are not met, and because we have so many expectations, nobody can meet all those expectations. We have some kind of issues with someone somewhere. He's not committed. They are lacking technical skills. There is no willingness to update or upgrade. They don't want to learn. In the beginning, he said that I am a learner. I am fast learner actually, not only learner. I'm fast learner, but now there is no willingness. She's only interested in 9-to-5 job. Whenever I ask more time, they are looking at the clock. So this is nothing frustrating more than this for a project manager when he is seeing that project demands more time from the people and this person is looking at the clock, looking to go home. He has no interest in the project. They're casual about the quality. So quality is not up to the mark. I need continuously verify their work. So somebody has to verify their work. Most of them seems to be not listening to me. They do their whatever they want, whatever I'm telling them. They're not following the plan, etc., etc. There's so many issues. Not all the issues with all the people, but some issues with some people. But just look at it, what an excellent manager asks. In fact, it doesn't ask from expectation of the people. He say, okay, let me set what I can do for the people. So it goes like that. How we talk to the people is like this, that we create a perception of our project and these perceptions are generally accepted perception because we learn them from the people around. A development project is better than a support project or maintenance project. This is general perception. In a power plant, people who are working to construct a new power plant are having a better job than the people who are maintaining the power plant. You go in these places, you will hear those things. And this is what our perception is also created. And when we talk to the people, we get this perception and we talk to those people understanding that he also has the same perception. But that may not be the case. The team member's perception could be very different. Okay. So what is the thing to be done? Listen, talk to him and understand what is his perception before we talk about anything. So what we need to do actually, we need to see that, listen to the person and understand the perception of the other person, what the perception of the other person. It may be very different than what our perception. Second thing, we should not believe in our general perception because it makes us negative thinker. As soon as we understand that we are in a development project or we are constructing a new plant or we are in creative position, we think that we have an age over the other people and the person will easily join us or will be it will be lucrative. A team member may be having some other value in the mind and may be thinking very differently. Or we say, okay, our project is a production support project. Nobody wants to be on this project. It will be very difficult. So let me do. So basically, it takes us to the negative side. While you will see that if you critically look at the project, every project has some giveaways, either good or bad. The important thing is that how these giveaways are presented to the people and how the team member react to this presentation. Now, when I say presentation, doesn't mean that you give a lucrative offer or you manipulate the things. No, there is no manipulation. I say have your attitude right before you expect your team member to have a positive attitude. Your project could be a production support. There will be no technical challenges. It's a very regular stuff to do. But you will see that there are different roles to play. A senior developer or a senior person or a supervisor or a senior team member can play a role of a team lead there. For a senior member, can team lead position may not be a challenge or may not be a takeaway. Before we talk about that, what this person will contribute, let's talk about what we can give to the person, because people will only contribute from their heart when they think that they have something to take away from this project. My skill will upgrade, my knowledge will upgrade, my experience will upgrade, or something like that. Or I get something, my salary will be raised. Even that is possible. So it is all about setting expectation. It's not about expecting people from the people, but setting the expectation to the people. And that job has to be done by the manager, not by the person. So what we need to do is understand the opportunities and threats in our project. What are the negative and positives of our project? First of all, we take a general perception, and based on that, we see that our project, as I said, our project is of this type, and we take a passive approach to that. Now, instead of that, every project, as I said, has something to give away. And until unless that giveaway have a value for the team member will not contribute from the heart or even hesitant to come on board. So first of all, we need to understand what are the opportunities and threats in our project. Second thing, how to present them to the people. How I should offer the opportunities. They are real opportunities. They are not manipulated. I'm not talking about manipulation. I'm not talking about offering something which is not there. I'm talking about let my mind goes right, and in a production support project, I find that there is a role upgrade possibility, opportunity for a team member. Can I present that opportunity to my team member? It's a real opportunity. It's not manipulation. If there is a threat that he having a cool life in this, normally the things which are creative, they keep the people on toes. They don't have any time to do there. So here when they come on the regular stuff project, the life will be cool. Now life will be cool, then there are other aspirations. There are other things which can be looked into. So when you present these things to the team members, listen to their voice, views. Those views will tell that the attitude is positive or negative. How don't put expectations in front of the people. Give them the opportunity, give them the also offer them the threats that this is the challenges and these are the opportunities. And give a freedom for the person to express himself. Now express himself means views. There is nothing wrong or right about it, views. It's a view. It can be anything. So there is nothing wrong and right about it. So person can be more easy, may not be when we are talking first time, it may not be very open, but it will be more comfortable position. The views could be more honest than actually when you set the expectation, the person will manipulate, start is manipulating that issue fit into, if you want to on the project, you want to fit into the project, fit into your role, into your expectation, and he do not want to get into the project, then he would like that I should not fit into the your expectation. But here there are no expectations set. Here that, okay, this project, if you come, this is what you get, this is what you lose, or this is what you will not there. Now tell me how you take it about it. Now these views will tell that is this person is right person to take or not. Maybe resources are always a problem, team members taking all the problem. You have, you will be running in the constraint. But I think having a unfit person, it's better not having the person. So there are opportunities to give away. Like there is a skill gap, the experience gap, there is a wish which are unfulfilled, the aspirations, the person want to do a certification. You say, okay, you come on this project, this is a cool project, you have enough time to prepare for your certification and pass it on. Maybe you live in this project for 6 months or a year and then move in and upgrade yours. During this time, upgrade yourself, develop new skills, do certification. There are more opportunities because the life is cool. You have time to do all these things. You are motivating a person to be action oriented and more contributory and more interested in the project because this is solving his purpose. Now, three, there are challenges, there are constraints, and when there are constraints, you can extend a helping hand. And when you extend a helping hand, who will be the person who will not reciprocate it? And then we have to negotiate. This is the giveaway, and this is the takeaway, and this is what you will contribute, and this is what I will contribute. This is what you will take away, and this is what I will take away, and this is what the project will take away. And everyone we are talking about, everyone, what everyone is taking away from this whole situation or this consolation. So strive to ensure that the people achieve what they come on the project, for what they have come on the project. And I'm sure they will reciprocate it. We should remember that everyone comes with this thing in his mind that what is in it for me, including us, including I. Whenever I go, I see that is what is meaningful for me in this. If you see this person will give A, B, C, D and does not expect anything, then I think you are expecting something miracle to happen. This person will work from the heart on this project. It will never happen if there is nothing for him or that value is not being created. So if we help them achieving what they look for, I'm quite sure they will not disappoint us. A word of caution that please do not generalize behavior of 5% over 95%. There are always 5% people who will not fit into any framework. Better, as I said in the previous habit, get away from people. But if you get hit by these people, do not take a caution approach with the rest of the 95%. Okay? If one person abuse the Xerox machine, please do not stop the Xerox machine for rest of the people, which is commonly happen in the offices. Right? Let me look at it if there are some questions and I will just quickly glance it. Maybe I will not answer all the questions, but if some is there, okay. No, I think everyone has kept the questions for the end. Okay, no problem. I hope it is going well. Okay, so the last thing is that what your team member will deliver is directly proportional to the quality of the project manager. What project manager said the things, the same thing the team will deliver. Team will not deliver anything different than what project manager want. You try this out, you will find that this sentence is always true. Let's look at, go to the fourth habit, and we're talking about that they look after their customers who actually feed the organization and the whole team. What does it mean? A normal practice is that when we talk about that look after their customers, what does it mean? A normal practice is to do what customer want. Absolutely right. There is nothing wrong about it, right? But is this, we are here. Now, when we talk about this, the underlying assumption is that delivering what customer want will make him happy. Customer knows very well that what he or she wants. We are vendor and we need to do what customer is asking us to do. Normal delivery itself is a challenge. Where is the time to think about such things? Sometimes delivery is very challenging. Who talks about, customer will talk about later. Okay. Think about customer a little later. Customer is more knowledgeable about us. Customer will tell us what he, she likes or dislikes. These are underlying assumptions, may not be all assumptions, maybe some of them, and which create a perception that if we do what customer is asking us to do, we'll make customer happy. But that's not the case. An excellent project manager asks or does what is in the interest of the customer. It may not be same what customer is asking for us to do. So what is in the interest of the customer? Customer may not be knowing what is in its interest. Why is it so? Because the underlying assumptions goes like that. Customer will be happy when their needs will be fulfilled. Customers may not be very good in understanding his needs. Most of the customers not like that. Normally, customers do not know clearly what they want. Often, customers are not good so good in translating needs into requirements. They will give you requirements, but those requirements may still not be meeting the needs. You deliver everything and tell that, okay, the project deliverables are exactly matching with the requirement. Customer will still not be happy because his work is not happening. Customer rarely share what they like or dislike. They will always be more diplomatic. Now what we have to do, we have to listen. Basically, we have to talk and talk and talk so that we can listen more and more and more. More customer will talk, more opportunity we give for customer to talk, more we understand what he likes or dislikes. Will not give tell you straightforward. You ask question what you like, he will never tell you. Moreover, he will tell you all the opposite things. Now we should understand that we are the expert, and that is why the customer has hired us. And we should take the ownership to avoid any future problem or issues to the customer. It is our responsibility to highlight the risk, issues, needs. We should guide to the customer to the right path. If he is telling something different, which we think is not the right path, we have to put the things, the facts together, put our opinion, provide him more options, and then allowing him to choose. Even if he choose the right wrong path, let's get back to him after some time. Let's go to the wrong path, but let's get back to the whenever you feel that there is things are maybe this time he will understand. Till that time he moved to the right path, we need to keep struggling on that. I will say struggle because it becomes a struggle if customer doesn't becomes too stubborn and doesn't understand the vendors, but we should not give away. Give new ideas and perspective to the customer so that the delivery will be better. We should not hide those things. Moreover, these are the opportunities where our scope will increase and we can earn more money from the customer. And customer normally like those things. He's ready to pay for that. Almost all customers need trusted partner. Is this right? Absolutely. Nobody comes to the vendor that he will merely do some job. Everyone, including us, when we go to some vendor, we think that if this person can take all my headache, and if he can do so, then I think job is done. How it will happen? It will happen through maintaining transparency. Because the transparency is not there, he will poke his nose in all your matters. He will not trust. And he keep micromanage, he will ask more questions, he will ask more frequent status. All these are symbols that things are not right. He doesn't understand. And connect personally, more informally. Talk and talk. Give him more opportunity to talk. Give more opportunity to listen to talk so that we listen more and more and understand more and more. This is normally a path for getting to the trusted partner. Things are start from the suspect when your marketing team is actually trying to find some suspects, trying to make them prospects. When you make suspect into prospect, basically delivery team's contribution is low, maybe 10%, just helping marketing or pre-sales team to get the prospect confirmed. Making prospect into customer, maybe you are providing some proposal, helping the team, maybe the delivery team's involvement increased by 20% or so. But when the person become customer, the delivery team's role significantly increase, making him customer to the client. Almost I will say it is 60 to 70% is delivery team's responsibility to make the customer into client. Who is the client? Client, the customer, again and again customer is client. Keep giving you orders is the client, is the person become client. Customer who buys for first time, buy again and again, become client. Then converting a client to advocate, I think is 90% responsibility on the delivery team. Who is advocate? Who recommend, who give referral, who say okay, who send other people also to us. That is 90% work is delivery for delivery people's team, 10% marketing of pre-sales. And if you make the advocate trusted partner means when a domain he has done with you become a friend of, we become friend, there is no sales team here, all delivery team, it becomes friend. So whenever something come related to this matter, he just leave it to us. He always discuss with us. There is no other chance. Become a trusted one. So if you go from suspect to smart, the delivery roles increases significantly when the person become customer. So our role is very, very significant in making the customer stay with the organization or stay with us. And the last thing we are talking about is about network. Is about building a network around. This is the most important habit. If this is not there, habit means these things work and these are underlying currents. They are underlying powers of the person. The project manager or anybody do not work on these things intentionally. They are almost work automatically all the time. So you're not intentionally working on it, but in the beginning, when you need to build this habit, we have to work very cautiously, very important, focusing on this, intentionally doing those things till they become habit. So like riding a bicycle, when we become habitual to the bicycle, we don't know when we are riding on it. We don't even bother about it. So these habits are like that. So a normal practice is that the contact the people when we need them. We contact the people when we need them. We need some support function. Okay, we need some people, we go to the HR, or we need some training, we go to the training department. we need some resources, go to the resource person. This is the life. We need some help, we go to the boss or the senior people. Whenever even we need something to be done, then we go to the team members. Otherwise, team members are also wandering around. They don't know who is the project manager. So project manager actually have all direction, talking to several people around. There is a whole ecosystem around project manager. Now, these are not the only people, okay, which you are seeing on the team. This is what I could accommodate in this slide. There are many more actually. They cannot be accommodated in the slides. I'm just trying to give a picture. The thing is that only a very small portion of the people on which the authority of the project managers work, that is their team. The rest of the people do not fall into project manager authority and they are not bound to obey your orders. So only influencing those people is the only way to go. Even building a team, you need to connect with the several people. So if you do not have connection with those people, you may not be able to build a good team. So when a project manager can contact with the people, when you need resource for their projects, a technical help is required, when you need to do some procurement, an expert is required, security of safety of the people is required, all the project requirements are there. So when we need something, we talk to the people. It hardly happens then we can, or with some people only, a very small portion of the people with whom we have a cup of tea share. They become our very close friend, but rest of the people are a distant dream. The question again comes that, is there anything wrong in contacting people when they need, when we need them? It is bound to happen. The answer is again no, but it is bare minimum. If we are contacting the people for the requirements, then it is, without that we really can't survive. But actually when we do so, our survival is also in question. So what the excellent project manager does is connect with the people when they are not needed. Basically try to socialize around and build the relationship with the people. Either they are useful in near future or distant future, they are around, we need to connect with them, we need to help them out, we need to offer something. To develop a relationship, to offer some help, this word work on reciprocation. You help someone, other person will help you, otherwise they will not. To share resources, you share the resources, then only the other people will share resources with you. To share knowledge, if I go and distribute the knowledge, only then the other people will share knowledge with me. Or if I reach out to the people and see that, see, I'm doing all these things, I can let you know about this, I can train you on this, so people know that this person, and they contact me when I am required. When I am required, when such kind of knowledge is required to that person. Even if third person is requiring that knowledge, this person will go to the third person saying that, okay, Vivek, knowing about all these things, you go to him and get the help because he is very helpful. So first thing, he's very helpful. Secondly, he's distributed his knowledge. So people come and they contact you and your network will grow. To train other people or just get together, just build a relationship, just say hello, or to initiate some volunteer activities. These are the very good things. So if you have something happening around and you see that something can be done, calling, creating a group and start doing those things, is create a kind of gelling. And volunteering is a very, very fantastic thing to develop a network, because whenever you take up some assignment with unknown people, those people become your friends and then brothers and then become very close partners. And some of them you can maybe having a business with them. The aim is to socialize. Socialization is a basic skill required with everyone. For some reason, project managers have got away from those socialization. They sit in their cabin and expect that everything will happen from there. As I wrote in my mail, that when you really need help in the project, when something is not getting resolved, then brainstorming with the people in the project itself only will not work. You have to go, leave the project here, go away, discuss the issues with other people you know. A fresh idea will come. A fresh suggestions will come. These people who are in the project will never go to that fresh idea. Not because they are not so intelligent, but because they are part of the problem. When somebody will come to you, you may be able to give a fresh idea to that person. And that's the power of network. If you are networking, you are coming together at some places and not utilizing that places to solve your problems. Actually, you have a network, but that network may not be working or may not be actively working. So discussing your successes, your challenges, your issues is what is required in the project. Let's look at this scenario. There is a resource manager who has a resource. A critical resource required by project, two project managers, same person, but there is only one person. The question arises, to whom this resource manager will give this resource? Who is the person? Now, project manager one has relationship with this resource manager. The second person is contacting the resource manager first time. Now, there is nothing great in guessing this. The resource will obviously go to first project manager because resource manager and project manager have this relationship. Other person doesn't come until I'm talking about there is no other influence. Okay, other influence can also play some part. Some pressure can come and the things can come. Resource manager need to say sorry to the project manager one because there is a relationship. In case of you are contacting first time, I'm contacting first time with the resource manager, he may not say even sorry. Okay, but relationship is not necessary. Even if you have a coffee together with this person at some point of time, you don't have any relationship, there are higher chances that this project manager will get the resource because this person know him, but the other person is totally unknown. You see, even the having coffee together is not even required. Even if you have just exchanged some views, you have just shaked hand, if you have just talked to each other sometime, maybe in the presence of third person, maybe you have just seen the face of each other, maybe you are familiar with the name of each other, still the chances of this critical resource going to first project manager are much higher than the other person because other person is totally unknown. So even if you have sometime told hello to everyone, you have improved your chances of getting help from those people when you really need it. Yeah. People are very, very intelligent. If you try to gel and try to build the network when you need them, people will realize this, that they are getting utilized. And nobody in this world would like to be utilized. They might like to help, but they don't want to be utilized. Okay, so let me summarize. The first is the first plan and then execute. Though it is very obvious, but it normally doesn't happen. Everybody knows that doing exercise and yoga is good for health, but you just count that how many percentage people do it. The thing here is, do it. Manage boss. So it's very important that we build the relationship in the upward direction. We help out our people. Look their expectations. try to see that we can negotiate what they are giving to this project and what this project can give back to them. Look after our customers. It's not about just doing what customer is asking us to do. It's about understanding what is in the interest of the customer and then doing it. Suggesting and then doing it. Don't do it without suggestion. Okay. First suggest, let customer say yes, and then if he says no, I think we have to go to the customer once again, maybe after some time, and build a network. Without, if you see the above four, the manage boss, live to the team members, look after their project customers. In fact, that is also about networking. It is also about socializing, talking more informal than formal. You see that everywhere we talk about talking informally than formally. So what is, we are actually, the message through this which I want trying to give is that it is about planning and then managing stakeholders around us for effective execution. So it is upward direction, it is downward direction, it is left and right. We need to manage the people around us. We need to take care of their expectations. We need to gel with them, build informal relationship, and bring and try to help them so that and credit the bank balance. So create a bank balance by helping out so that we can draw some interest out of it little later. It is less formal and more informal. So as part of this webinar, we have focused on what. We are not focused on how. What we are talking about is what to be done, not how it to be done. Now, how it could be a little tougher. So it could be easier said than done. Now, we are talking about habits. Habits are die hard. They are difficult to change. I'm saying difficult to change. They are not impossible to change. Once you realize that I need to change, you change next day. If I see that I need to do this, I adopt it. Only thing is that I have to do this perfectly. I may not be perfect on first day because these things need to be learned, cannot be taught so easily. Therefore, we need to practice. Okay, and if you have any question, I'm here to, you please post it on the question panel. I will take those questions. Okay, let me check if what are the questions coming up. Okay, so in this case, is resource manager is not biased? Yeah, okay, absolutely biased, actually, absolutely right. In fact, bias is a part of the life. Everybody is biased. And this bias is coming because of the informal relationship. Now, the thing is that this is a fact. You cannot deny. You can say, okay, the resource manager should not be biased. But this is the fact, he is biased. Everyone is biased. When somebody comes to me, I know one person and I do not know the other person and try to help him out. The person I know. Now, everybody is not at the position of a judge. So he is bound with the things of the law that he has to be impartial, irrespective of who is in front of that. But we are living a normal life where we try to help our friends. And you see that everyone is biased in that manner. The thing is that how we can see that this bias work for us, not against us. Habit two, how come, I hope I answered that. How come review done by others will be wrong signal for manager and boss relationship is shaky. Okay, see, if you have delivered something, I'm talking about review by other people as a part of the process is absolutely fine. But if it is not part of the process, you are delivering something and he's asking other person to verify that it is right. If it is a part of the process, it has to happen. But I'm talking about that it's not a part of the process. In fact, the deliverables are somebody, the boss asks you to do something, you deliver it to the boss, and before boss take up and look at this, he asks some ABC person to look at it. Means ABC's person is more trustworthy than you. If you are new, you can live with this for some time. But if this persists, then I think we need to look at it. There is some problem. How we manage conflict of interest from bosses? Okay, I think we need to be more specific about what kind of conflict of interest you come over here, because conflict of interest is a little touchy area, and as the situation changes, the conflict of interest changes, and a very tricky situation. Normally, the situations are very tricky actually. So give me a little more specific things that what actually you mean here by conflict of interest. In terms of people being managed under the project, okay, so where is the conflict of interest? Okay, I come back to you. Just maybe try to mention something specific. I come back to you. Let me take up the other question. Okay, favors towards others. Okay. Yeah, this is, see, I tell you one thing. This is what I said, that it is a network kind of things, that try to the building relationship is what is networking, and it is to everyone. And this may happen that the bosses may favor some people and may not favor some people. And that is about relationship. I'm talking about the general thing. I'm not talking about the ideal things. I'm talking about what is you see around you. This will happen. And the thing is that how we use this to work for us. This is what I'm talking about. This is bound to happen. When a boss is having some good relation with some team members, or direct relationship with the, especially I tell you the situation when you take up a position of a project manager and you replace a person who become your boss. Okay, you might, many times it happens that I get into a project, I replace a person and that person become my boss actually. Whenever he elevated and I as placed him. Now you see that all the team members have better relationship with my boss than me. This is a very tricky situation. If you do not actively manage this situation, everyone will be more comfortable with the boss than you or than me if I am in that place. And if any situation come, then instead of they're reaching out to me, they're reaching out to my manager. And many people might have realized it. So in this situation, we need to build relationship with these people, with the people under me, and use them as a more a friend than actually the boss, than actually their reports. Otherwise, this becomes a very tricky situation, and many times it happens. So these bias are there in the system. I'm just talking about that, how we can manage these bias to work for us. Okay, where is that? Let me take up the new one. One suggestion, hope you will take it in right spirit. You might need to fine tune your grammar and spelling in the presentation. It is recorded and will go to many persons. I will definitely do that. Thank you very much for this suggestion. Don't you think managing the bosses will somewhere hurt his her ego. Okay, when we are talking about managing the boss, we are not talking about that we are giving some directions or something to bosses. Actually, we are talking about to manage this relationship better. We are not talking about that we are giving directions to our see, manage is something like that we are giving direction to someone, like our team members. We're not talking about that. We are talking about building this relationship better and getting into the understanding of what bosses want, what boss is looking for, how he will be able to what will make him success, where I can contribute, like that. So there is no direction we are talking about. So we definitely should not hit his ego at all. And if we hit the ego, then I think we will be doing the reverse job as such. Example, easier said than done. You mentioned then, okay, I will check this. I will correct this. Okay, in terms of people being managed under the project. Okay. Yeah, I think I answered this. How to manage team member who takes their task casually? See, it is a lack of interest. And say not setting the right expectations. Often we go lose, our team member also go lose. So lousy, we become lousy, the other team members also go lousy actually. That is what the thing is, one thing. So our gesture may not be right. We may accept, at some point of time, we accept the poor quality, but some point of time we do not. We have to be a little consistent in this manner. So we need to look at us, that are we giving some kind of signal that which will make people to think that, okay, this type of quality will work. See, when the pressure comes, we will say, okay, let's do this. Then everyone take advantage of that situation, and later they try to deliver the similar kind of quality. Now the thing is that once we accept something at some point of time, I think it's quite possible that at some point of time we accept it, but we also have to act that this is not an acceptable quality. We need to go ahead and correct it down the line. Then it gives the right message. So what I have seen, when the team members are not giving casual about quality, actually the project managers have accepted quality, inferior quality, several times. So they take that as an example and deliver a poor quality thing. And then people say, okay, fine, I think this is, and sometimes it is acceptable, so they try it out. So till the time it is acceptable, it is fine. When you object it, they go back and do it. But it hits you every time. You say, yeah, every time I have to tell them that you correct the quality. The quality. It means we need to be a little more consistent in our expectations or of the message which we are giving to the people. Okay. You said it right. Okay, how many PDUs can we claim for this webinar? It is 1.5 PDUs you can claim. Can I add you in my LinkedIn? What's your ID? Okay, you can search for Vivek Prakash, and maybe if you go the on the page where you have registered, where my profile is mentioned, there is a link also mentioned which will directly take you to my ID actually. So you can search for Vivek Prakash, I think something project management. I don't know how to search it. I never search myself. So drop me a mail. I think it should be okay. I will definitely like to add you. Does this our attitude of helping team members indirectly takes off the responsibility from the team? No. You should not take the responsibility of the team members. You are helping them to do their job, and basically you are guiding them to what is in this project for them. You should not do their work. This is not advisable. Doing team members' job is not advisable. Moreover, you will be killing them as such. You will be killing yourself. You will be killing them also, because they will also not do. They will take it, take this as an example. Okay, so they have to do it. You can help them to do it. You can provide. So what is the project manager's job? Is to remove the roadblocks, remove the hurdles, see that what is stopping people to do something, remove those things, not to start doing their job. If you start doing their job, then I think it will be a reverse thing. Moreover, they should do some of your job so that they elevate themselves to your level. Thanks for the great presentation questions. Okay, we'll receive an email with details of webinar so that we can claim PDU. Sure, you will get an email about confirming your presence here. If PDUs exceed 60 in the given cycle, does it carry towards or forward to the next cycle on the last year? On the third year, if you whatever you get, if it is over and above 60, it will be they will be carry forward to the next cycle, not before that. Okay, so it's 9:31 and I don't see any question coming up right now. So thank you very much for coming over here and taking valuable time and joining this place. I hope this knowledge is usable for you. You will be able to use it at your workplace. We will send you an email confirming your attendance in this webinar. And you can use this email as a confirmation of attending this webinar and claim 1.5 PDUs. A link will also be provided in the email for providing your feedback. I think I have got one feedback already. I will take care of these things next time. Sure, and I will also update this presentation before I upload it for you to download it. And this recording of this webinar will be available and we'll send it out to you for to access it. Thank you once again for joining here. I look forward to meet you in the future webinars. Wish you all the best.